This time, we're going to start it off with a video put together by Brent and his family.
Long ago, there was this angel that told Mary that she was expecting a baby, and then they went to Bethlehem, and then it was a long ways, and then they finally got there, and then they didn't know where to stay, and then they found a stable, and then they went in there and spent the night there, and then Mary had her baby.
Mary and Joseph named the baby Jesus because just like the angel told them.
And then some shepherds were watching their sheep, and then they saw a big bright star, and then there was angels all over the sky saying glory to God in highest.
And then a lot of angels came and they said, don't be afraid.
There's a star, and if you follow it to Bethlehem, you'll see the Christ child.
There were wise men that were looking up in the sky, and they saw this huge star.
And then wise men looked up at the star, and then they decided to follow it, and then they went to see baby Jesus, and then they brought baby Jesus gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
And that is the story of Christmas.
Merry Christmas to all, and to all good night.
We're going to play O Come Emmanuel, and we'd like to invite you to join us in singing on the second time.
If you'd please stand and join us in singing, that'd be great.
may be seated. These guys are doing a great job. They were supposed to practice Monday night. The weather obviously threw a wrench in that. They were going to come a little bit early and run through things tonight. The weather threw a little wrench in that and them all getting here. So we appreciate your service. And you guys did a great job on the fly there, adapting and adjusting. So we appreciate that. At this time, we're going to do a little bit of an interactive reading. And so I've asked a couple of our ministry board members and Brent, our youth guy, to play a part in this interacting. And so they can come up here and get ready. But you all are going to have a part with them at certain points throughout. So I'm going to read a script as a narrator, and they're going to add some elements as we go along. You are going to have a part in that. Whenever I say worship, I'm going to pause, and all of you are going to shout, not just say it, but shout hallelujah. You got that? So let's practice your line. When I say worship, you say hallelujah. Almost felt like a cheerleader there for a minute, but we'll do that and listen to this Christmas story from Scripture, but with a little bit of interpretive license in it as well. So Mary was home in her little village when all of a sudden an angel came and spoke to her. The angel, Gabriel, told her not to be afraid. The angel told her that she was going to give birth to God's son. The angel announced to her that this little baby would be the savior of the world. After this heavenly messenger visited Mary, he went to Joseph, who was engaged to Mary, and told him that Mary's child was from God and that they should give him the name Jesus. And Joseph worshiped
hallelujah
God. Meanwhile, there were some wise men who were off in a faraway land studying the Bible, and some shepherds who were taking care of their sheep. The shepherds had no idea that anything great was happening, but the wise men had learned from the Old Testament that the Savior of the world would be born in Bethlehem, and the wise men were eagerly searching for the time this would happen. Because Caesar Augustus had decreed that everyone must go to their hometown to be counted for a census, Mary and Joseph traveled to Bethlehem, the place the wise men had read that the Savior would be born, and the place where Jesus' great ancestor David had once been a shepherd. When they arrived in Bethlehem, the only place left for them to stay was a stable. It was in this stable that Mary gave birth to Jesus, just like the angel had predicted. After Mary gave birth, an angel appeared to a group of shepherds who were taking care of their sheep. When the shepherds saw this angel, they were terrified. But the angel said to the shepherds, "Do not be afraid, for I bring you good news of great joy for everyone. Today in the city of Bethlehem, a Savior is born." Even though the shepherds were not technically wise men, they knew enough to believe the angel and search diligently for baby Jesus. When the shepherds found Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, they worshiped
hallelujah
Jesus, and then went and told everyone what God had said to them through the angel. A little while later, the wise men, who were waiting anxiously for the coming Messiah, saw a star in the sky. God had placed the star there. I'm not sure if the angels flew by it on their way back to heaven, or if the shepherds saw it out in their fields, but the wise men certainly recognized it as a sign from God to lead them to Jesus. These wise men set out to visit Jesus, just as the shepherds had said. When the wise men arrived at Bethlehem, they bowed down and worshiped
hallelujah
Jesus, just like the shepherds did. The wise men presented Jesus with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And so the shepherds, who were wise men, and the angels, who were like shepherds to the sheep, though they didn't appear to the wise men, and the wise men who followed the star like the shepherds followed the angels, all worshiped
Hallelujah.
Jesus. And tonight we have the opportunity to celebrate the birthday of Jesus. Just like the angels, shepherds, and wise men did all those years ago. We celebrate because this Jesus has come to bring salvation to all today who worship
Hallelujah.
Him as Lord and believe in his name. Thank you, guys. Great job. At this time, Judy Nichols is going to play a special for us on the piano. Since Thanksgiving, we've been doing a series on Sunday mornings entitled, Is There Room? And we've been challenged with the question, is there room in your life for God to work? Is there room in your life for worship? Is there room in your life for God's love? And is there room in your life for wonder? This coming Sunday, a couple days away, we invite you to join us as we consider the question, is there room in your life for hope? But tonight, we want to take a moment and consider the question, is there room in your life for God's glory? If you have a Bible and want to follow along, you can turn to Luke chapter 2. If you don't have a Bible, that's fine. We have the verses up here on the screen, so you can follow along with us that way. But Luke chapter 2, start by reading verses 8 through 11. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. For today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." In verse 9, we read that the angel of the Lord appeared and that the glory of the Lord shone around the shepherds. Now, I don't know about you, but as I typically read through that account in Luke chapter 2, I tend to skip past verse 9. Just read it real fast so we can get to the good news of verse 11, that today a Savior has been born. But yet if we skip over verse 9, if we skip over the glory of the Lord, we miss something of great significance. And so tonight, I want to just ask and answer briefly two questions as it relates to the glory of the Lord. And the first question we need to ask is simply this: what is the glory of the Lord that appeared? Well, when the scriptures talk about the glory of the Lord, it is often referring to what theologians call Shekinah glory. And the Shekinah glory is the visible, manifest presence of God. R.C. Sproul writes that the Shekinah was the blazing, blinding glory of God. We read that when the Bible was glory was visible, people hid their eyes from it, that they were overwhelmed by it, driven to their knees, because there was nothing in nature that could compare to the Shekinah glory. So I want you to pause and think about that just for a moment. As the shepherds are there in the fields, an angel of the Lord appears to them, and that would be pretty intimidating enough. If an angel appeared to you, I imagine you would be a little bit frightened, a little bit intimidated. But on top of that, the glory of God, the manifest presence of God Himself, shows up in that very moment. And naturally, they're afraid. But to help us understand the significance of this, I want us to look at just a couple other appearances of the glory of the Lord. See, this wasn't something that happened often. When the glory of the Lord first appeared, it appeared to Adam and Eve in the garden. There they got to walk and talk with the Shekinah glory, with the very presence of God in perfect fellowship. But when sin entered the world, they didn't have that privilege. They didn't have that opportunity anymore. Another time we read of the Shekinah glory coming is when the Israelites are in the wilderness. And Moses is about to go up the mountain on Mount Sinai. And all of a sudden, as he goes up there to receive the Ten Commandments, the glory of the Lord settles on top of that mountain. Now, if you've ever seen a picture of Mount Sinai, it's pretty impressive in and of itself. But with the Shekinah glory was thunder and lightning and great power and majesty. And not just Moses got to see this, but all of Israel could see the glory of the Lord. We know the glory of the Lord appeared when they dedicated the tabernacle, and then later when they dedicated the temple in 1 Kings chapter 8. But after centuries of sin and rebellion against God, the glory of the Lord leaves Israel. It leaves the temple, and you can read about that in Ezekiel chapter 40. And so for the last 400 years or longer, the glory of the Lord has not appeared to Israel. That is a long time for God to be silent. That's a long time to wait. That's a long time for it to seem like God just isn't there, that he's not ever going to show up again. And yet on this night, at the birth of God's Son, the glory of God appears, not just to the shepherds, but the glory of God appears in the manger. This would not be the last time in the life of Jesus when the glory of God appears. John tells us, John 1:14, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, full of grace and truth. Jesus himself was God in the flesh. He was the visible representation of God in all his glory. And yet we know that during Jesus' life and ministry, he veiled that glory. He did not fully reveal and show himself to people just by that appearance. And yet on the Mount of Transfiguration, for a brief moment, he temporarily showed that glory to three of his disciples. And it says there that his face shone like the sun and his clothes became white as the light, that he unveiled his disciples for these, unveiled his glory for these disciples to see there on the mountain, that Jesus really was God in the flesh. But since that appearance. Since Jesus ascended back into heaven after his resurrection, the glory of God has not reappeared on this earth in that way. But friends, one day we know that the glory of God will reappear, that Jesus will come back. And not only will Jesus come back, not only will we have the opportunity to dwell with God forever, but in heaven, in the new city, Jerusalem, we don't need the sun. We don't need the moon. We won't need the stars because John tells us in Revelation chapter 21, the city does not need the sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the lamp, or the Lamb, is its lamp. So imagine how special, imagine how significant at this moment that the glory of God appears to these shepherds, that they get to see it. And this glory wasn't just up in the sky. It didn't say the glory was with the angels. It says the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they, talking about the shepherds, were terrified. God literally came down for his people to see and to know and to interact with. And that really leads us to our second question that we need to ask and answer about God's glory tonight. And it's this: what is your response to the glory of the Lord? And as we look at the response of the shepherds to God's glory, we'll see what our response ought to be. First of all, we see that the shepherds were terrified, and rightfully so. Now, we know because of man's sinfulness that we can't look on the face of God and live. And certainly, when we consider the kind of reputation the shepherds had back in that time, it would not appear that the glory of God was coming for a nice, friendly visit. It would appear that the glory of God was coming for judgment. The shepherds were not the good guys in the story. They appear to be the good guys here in Luke chapter 2, but in those days, shepherds were looked down upon. They were dishonest people. They were outcasts. They were considered thieves and robbers, and nobody trusted them at all. And yet, this is who the glory of God appears to. And so naturally, they're terrified. And yet that night, as the glory of God appeared, he wasn't coming to condemn the world. He wasn't coming to settle the score with those dirty, rotten shepherds. No, he was coming to announce the birth of his son and to give validity to the angel's message. Can you imagine really what a glorious sight this must have been? In the scriptures, God and his presence is often referred to as inexpressible light, that it's beautiful, that it's brilliant, that it's magnificent, that the light of the sun can't even compare to the light of God's glory. John in 1 John 1:5 says that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. And so it's easy to understand why the shepherds weren't just a little bit afraid, and they were terrified. I mean, these guys weren't normally cowards. Right? They stayed up all night in the dark, which can be scary enough, particularly when you're out in the woods, in the wilderness, and you hear all these strange noises. They fought off wild animals, lions, bears. They fought off robbers who were trying to come and steal the sheep. They had to watch the sheep in all kinds of inclement weather through bad storms. So they weren't easily intimidated. And yet, when the glory of the Lord shows up, these guys are terrified. In fact, the King James Version says that they were sore afraid. And that means that they were more scared than they'd ever been before in their life. These guys were terrified because they understood just how glorious God is. And friends, when we think of the glory of God, we ought to have a little bit of fear, and by fear, I mean more the sense of awe, just like the shepherds. You know, perhaps this is a little bit harder for us to understand because we've never really seen the glory of God in that way, and yet have seen the glory of God. It just looks a little different. We've seen the glory of God on the pages of Scripture. That as we read Scripture, we can see who God is, we can see Jesus in the flesh, and we can see him in all his glory and the great things that he has done. But not only that, we know that the heavens declare the glory of God. All of creation reveals God's glory to us. Now, all of creation has been marred by sin, and so it doesn't quite look as God intended. And yet, even as you look around at creation, there are things in creation that literally have the power to take your breath away. That they are great, they are grand, and they are glorious. And those things give us just a taste of the glory of God. But perhaps one of the neatest ways that we see the glory of God represented here on this earth is through one another. See, when we put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ to save us from our sin, Jesus comes to live inside of us. As Paul put in Colossians, it's Christ in us, our hope of glory. And so as people look at followers of Jesus, you know what? They can see a little bit of God's glory in us. And so the glory of God this Christmas has appeared to us. And like the shepherds, we need to have a sense of awe, a sense of fear, a sense of reverence at just how grand and great and how glorious God is. Well, the second response that we see of the shepherds is that they proclaimed the glory of God. Luke chapter 2, verse 17 says, when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. What they had seen was so awesome, it was so spectacular, that they just had to tell other people about it. We do this with all kinds of things, right? When we go out into the world, we find this really good place to eat. We go tell people about it. That place in Cadillac is Taco Bell. I don't know if you guys knew that, but just wanted to share that with you. You know, when we find that perfect vacation spot, we want to tell people about it. You got to check this out. You got to go there. It was so great. We're showing people pictures, right? When we find that maybe significant other who will one day become our spouse, we don't just keep it to ourselves, right? We go and we tell people about it. We're excited. It brings joy within us. When we witness the perfect come-from-behind victory from our favorite sports teams, man, we tell people about it. Did you see that? It was awesome. We don't get to do that with the Lions very much, but with other teams, we can see that. You know, students, maybe you see it. You are going online and you watch that Dude Perfect video that's just so awesome, and you got to go and share it with all your friends, right? When we see these things that are great and grand and glorious and just awesome, it's natural for us to talk about it. It's not hard. It just comes really easy. It creates excitement. It creates joy within us. And friends, when we encounter the glory of God, guess what? That creates excitement. That creates joy with us because the glory of God is like nothing we have ever seen. It is good. There is hope. There is peace. It is everything that we could have imagined and more. And so like these shepherds, when we encounter the glory of God, we need to go out and share that with others so that they can have the hope that these shepherds had, so that they can have the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. We need to share the glorious experience of when we met Jesus for the first time. Do you remember that day when you put your faith and trust in Jesus? When your eyes were open and all of a sudden it just made sense and you saw Jesus for who he really was and you said, I need to put my faith and trust in him. And we need to tell that experience to other people so they can see the glory of God. We need to tell people about the glory of God as he works in our lives. Did you hear about what God's doing? Let me tell you what God's doing in my life today. We need to share the glory of God as we encounter him on the pages of Scripture. Here's how Jesus revealed himself to me today through what I read. God's glory is not meant to be kept a secret. That you and I were created in the image of God. And God, if he is grand and glorious, then we represent a little bit of that glory. And we have the responsibility to reflect his glory to the rest of the world. And so like we sing this time of year, go tell it on the mountain. That's exactly what we need to do with God's glory. We need to proclaim it. And the third response we see from the shepherds is that they lived for God's glory. They lived for God's glory. Luke chapter 2, verse 20 tells us that the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. In other words, this experience changed them. It changed them so much that they began living for the honor and glory of God. And friends, when you and I encounter the glory of God, it ought to change us as well. We ought to begin to live our lives for his honor and glory. Paul told us, 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. We're to live every single moment of every single day living for his glory alone. Doesn't matter what you're doing. So as you get in the car and you head to work or you head to school that day, do all to the glory of God. You know, as you're staying at home, maybe with your kids or you're in quarantine or whatever, do all for the glory of God. When you're just cruising down the road, listening to music, do all for the glory of God. When you're folding laundry, when you're cleaning the house, do all to the glory of God. In other words, we need to live as though the glory of the God is the most important thing in the world. And it actually ultimately is. We need to live for God's glory. We were created to have that relationship with him. We were created to reflect that glory to the rest of creation. And so our lives need to be devoted to living for his honor and glory. The shepherds, when they encountered the glory of God, they went out praising God for everything that they had seen and heard. They proclaimed it, it changed them, and they lived for his glory. Well, I've tried to keep things pretty short and simple, but just so we can really drive home the application, how we should respond tonight, let me just challenge you this way. Number one, you may be here tonight and you need to reclaim a little bit of that fear and awe for the glory of God. That maybe when you were a new believer, God was really fresh, God was really exciting, but now that you've known him for a while, you've heard about him, you've gone to church all your life, maybe you've lost a little bit of that sense of glory. It's not because God's lost any of his glory, it's because we've lost sight of his glory. And so tonight, maybe you need to reclaim through the pages of Scripture a little bit of the glory of God. Maybe you need to, as you look at other Christians around you and hear what God is doing in their lives, need to reclaim a sense of the glory of God. And you need to respond in fear and awe for what he's doing. Secondly, some of you may be here, may be watching online, and you need to receive God's glory. By that, I mean you need to put your faith and trust in Jesus to save you from your sin. That maybe tonight you've realized for the first time exactly who Jesus is and how grand and how great and how glorious he is and what he did by sending his son to come to this earth to die on the cross for our sins. You know, John wrote John 1, 9 through 12. He said, "The true light that gives light to everything was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor of a husband's will, but born of God." See, this Christmas, as always, God's free gift of salvation is available to you. And if you've never put your faith and trust in Jesus to save you from your sin, you can do that tonight. If you're not sure how, I encourage you to come talk to me in person after the service. You can come talk to one of the men that you saw up here. They'd love to explain that to you and tell you how you can have that relationship with him. If you're watching online, shoot me a message, and I'd love to get a hold of you and tell you how you can have that right relationship with God. But third, some of you here may need to proclaim God's glory. You've received it, you know about it, but you're not really sharing it with others. As we've talked about tonight, God's glory is meant to be shared. And so who can you proclaim the glory of God to this Christmas? You can start by doing it right here, by sharing how you've encountered God already in your life this week, whether through it's something you read, maybe through it's a circumstance that God orchestrated in a particular way. But who can you proclaim the glory of God to? And then lastly, I would just challenge you this way. All of us here need to make it a point to live for the glory of God. So as you look back at your life this week, just evaluate it. So far, it's only Thursday. Have everything that I've done been for the glory of God? Chances are, if you're like me, probably not. There's been things I've done this week that were selfish. There are things that I've done this week that I've done out of pride. There are things that I've done this week where I've responded in anger when I shouldn't have. I haven't always lived for the glory of God. But friends, as we encounter God's glory on a regular basis, it ought to change us. And we ought to make a commitment each and every day to live in light of his glory. Now, I don't know what that may look like for you. Maybe you need to do that at work, that you're not totally living for the glory of God at work. You're getting a little flexible with your time, spending too much time on Facebook, on the work computer, or maybe at school, you know, you're supposed to be working on that assignment that your parents, if you're homeschooled, or your teacher has given to you, and yet you're doing other things. You're making those more important. Live for the glory of God in those things. Maybe you need to live for the glory of God in your free time. Maybe you need to live for the glory of God in the things that you watch or the things that you listen to. Students, maybe you need to live for the glory of God, again, while you're at school. Maybe in response to your homework assignment or when your parents ask you to do those things or chores around the house. You know, maybe you need to live for the glory of God when you're with your friends and the decisions that you tend to make when you're with them. Again, I don't know what it is for you, but commit tonight to live for the glory of God. Bottom line here tonight, simply this, the glory of God is here. That's what Christmas, again, is all about. The Word became flesh and we have seen his glory. So the glory of God is here, but how is God's glory visible through you? Matthew 5:16, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good work and glorify your Father who is in heaven. God's glory is meant to be visible through you. And so how is it this Christmas? Well, let's pray. Father God, we thank you again that the glory of God came down. Lord, we do not deserve to even have a chance to encounter your glory other than in judgment. And yet, God, Christmas reminds us that we have the chance to encounter your glory in an intimate relationship with you, the God of this universe. So, Lord, we thank you for that. God, I pray that you would help us to reclaim a sense of your glory and that we would respond in fear and awe. Lord, I confess those times when I see you for who you really are and I'm not that impressed, or I don't allow it to change me. Forgive me for that. God, give me a sense of your glory. Help us as a church to respond in fear and awe to the truth of who you are and what you've done and are doing and will do in our midst. God, I pray if there's any here tonight who have not yet received you as Lord and Savior of their life, I pray that tonight they would have seen you in all your glory and that they would bow the knee and that they would confess with their mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and that they would put their faith and trust in you to save them from their sin. God, I pray tonight that you would help us to share your glory as we gather with family, as we go back to work next week. Help us to tell others about the glory of your Son and about the glory of the Father. And God, I pray that you'd help all of us to live each day for your honor and glory. It's because of you that we live and we move and we have our being. On our own, we can do nothing apart from you. But because we have a relationship with you, because we have seen your glory, Lord, we have a chance to respond and to live each day in light of your glory. And so help us to do that, I pray. We commit and we entrust these things to you, and we ask them in the name of Jesus. Amen. This time, I'm going to invite you to take your candles. Those of you, again, 12 and up, we've given you the opportunity to grab a candle. If you didn't grab one on your way in, you can sneak out. There's a couple baskets either side of the main door there. You can grab one of those. We're going to have a couple ushers, the two Brents, come down, and they're going to light a candle on the end of some of the pews. And then as you get lit, we just ask that you would pass that down. But God's glory, as we talked about tonight, is expressed in terms of light. And so we have a visible representation with that candle of the glory of God in our midst. And as we pass it down, flame from person to person, we have the chance to share God's glory with those around us, a reminder of the truths that we learned. And while we do that, the team is going to lead us in a couple songs. So we invite you to stand. The ushers will come and begin lighting those candles this time. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5 that you are the light of the world. And so we have the chance to go out and to proclaim his power and his glory this Christmas. As that, as you depart from here, that you blow out your candles. I'll dismiss in prayer in a minute, and the lights will come on while we're praying. Brent, if you would hit those for us, either Brent, that's not real specific there. Those lights will come back on. Please, after you blow out your candle, put it back in the baskets where you got them, and we'll take care of them from there. Thanks for worshiping with us. May you have a Merry Christmas. Let me close in prayer. Father God, we do thank you again for the chance to be here and to worship you. God, we thank you that tonight is not about us, that it's not about presents, that it's not about even family time, that it's not about just a spirit of joy. But Lord, we thank you that Christmas is about you and the work that you started from eternity past when you preordained, predestined your son to come to this earth to die for the sin of the world. And so God, we thank you for Jesus, and may we honor him and glorify him now and forevermore. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Merry Christmas again. You're dismissed.